This is second lecture on Doherty power amplifier, and we will continue the story of this amplifier from the last lecture. So recall that Doherty power amplifier has this architecture where we have one power amplifier and then lambda by 4 line. And this is feeding to the load, but there is another power amplifier called auxiliary power amplifier, which is also feeding to the same load. And this one is main power amplifier, this is auxiliary power amplifier, and this comes into activity only when input is greater than a certain threshold, which we can decide, while this main power amplifier is always active. In the last class, we analyzed the Doherty power amplifier for lower input. That means when this beta is less than this threshold value, and we found that when this Z0 is, so for Z0 is equal to R optimum and RL is equal to beta T R optimum, the voltage at the load reaches to VDD, sorry, voltage here at the drain of the main power amplifier reaches to VDD for input is equal to this threshold value, and here our optimum is equal to 2 VDD by IP, and this is the load which for class B will give the maximum swing of VDD when the input is maximum, that means when beta is equal to A 1. That means input is equal to A, and for that case we get the maximum efficiency for class B as pi by 4. And plot for the this drain voltage, which we have designated as VDM, is like this. This is VDD and it reaches to VDD for this threshold. Now we need to find out what will be the VDM, or rather ensure that VDM is going to be equal to VDD for the rest of the portion. So this is now what we have to ensure, and for that we will have to find out what should be the current provided by auxiliary power amplifier to the load. And keep in mind that for this analysis we are taking both main and the auxiliary power amplifier in class B mode of operation. So now we will try to carry out the analysis to find out the current provided by this, so that now the drain voltage for the main power amplifier equals VDD for the rest of the input. And we will be very frequently using three formulas which we already listed. So Z in RL is equal to Z0 square. This is for a lambda by 4 line where Z in is this thing, RL is the load which is terminated at the other end, and Z0 is the characteristic impedance. Similarly, the voltage DM and the current it is providing I1, ratio of this to voltage here at this end, at the other end of the transmission line, divided by current it is providing will be equal to z naught square, and third formula is, so this is formula A, formula B, and third is going to be VDM, product of this voltage and current, and product of this voltage, this is going to be zero. So these three formulas we will use for this class as well, and these all three can be derived by writing the voltage and current wave equations for this lambda by 4 line, and finding their values at this end and at the other end, and then relating these quantities. So for this case, now we want to analyze this duality power amplifier. So for this case, the load modulation is going to be the key phenomena that occurs, and because of that, the drain voltage of the main power amplifier can be maintained to VDD. And so we will now draw the equivalent model of this duality power amplifier. Now both the amplifiers will be conducting. So we will substitute each of the power amplifier by current source, and that too we will consider the fundamental current of each of these two amplifier, because it is the fundamental which flows through the load. Others get short circuited by the parallel RL connected in these amplifiers. And for a moment we will overlook this, so we will have only three elements: this power amplifier, and the lambda by 4 line of the main power amplifier, and of course the load. So here you see that both are feeding to load. So the equivalent model is going to be like this. So we have main power amplifier, which provides fundamental current I1, and this is the lambda by 4 line, and at the other end we have load RL. Now this is also being fed by the auxiliary power amplifier, which we will designate as a current source of fundamental value I2. And although this auxiliary power amplifier is being fed by lambda by 4 line, we are overlooking at the moment. Later on we will point out what is the importance of that line. So this is the circuit which we have to analyze, and as per our designation, the voltage at this end is VDM, the drain of the main power amplifier, and current is of course I1, and this input impedance we will call as Zin, and the voltage across load will be labeled as VL, and the current at the other end of this line will be labeled as I1L. So this is going to be different from this current which is entering here, and this is of course I2, and the net current through load is going to be IL. So though the physical load connected here is RL, because it experiences current from second amplifier, the auxiliary amplifier also, so the load looking towards this side is no longer going to be RL. It will get modified, for which we have already derived the formula Z1L. So where Z1L will be given as RL into 1 plus the second current that is flowing through it divided by the first current with respect to which we are trying to find out the effective load, which is Z1L. So these are the some of the parameters associated with this equivalent circuit. Now in this equivalent circuit, our objective is to find out what should be I2, so that for this range of input, for higher input, this drain voltage becomes fixed at VDD, so that the main power amplifier operates at the higher efficiency. And we will use some of the results from the previous analysis, that means for the lower input analysis, where it was found that, so given is this characteristic impedance is R optimum, and this RL was beta T R optimum, and the fundamental current I1 is beta into Ip by 2. So where we are assuming that the drain current of the main power amplifier is half wave rectified with peak of Ip. So fundamental is going to be Ip by 2, and this comes because now when the input changes, the fundamental is also going to change. So this is given, and of course those three formula that we will be using and this expression also, these are the known things. So what we have to now find is I2 such that the drain voltage of the main power amplifier becomes VDD for input greater than threshold but less than equal to the maximum value. So this is going to be the objective of this analysis. So we will start the analysis from this end because it is this voltage which we want to become equal to VDD. So we will write the expression for this and start the analysis. So this VDM from Ohm's law is Zin into I1. So this is the starting equation for this analysis. Now see what we want is, we want the expression for I2 under this condition. So what we have to do, we have to start from this equation and start doing the manipulation and ultimately arrive at equation containing, so from here arrive at an equation containing VDM I1, because I1 is known, and I2, so that we can put this thing equal to VDD. I1 is given and then we can find out I2. So this is going to be the starting point and this is the destination. So here now we will start getting rid of this Zin and slowly move towards this equation. So Zin, we know that we can use this equation FA1 to find out Zin. So VDM becomes Z0 square by, so keep in mind this equation was written for RL, that means the load that this current perceives is RL. So when this equation is adapted to this scenario, the impedance which is going to get modified by this lambda by 4 line is going to be Z1L not RL, right? So this is not going to be RL, rather this is going to be Z1L. So Z1L gets transformed by lambda by 4 line to give Zin. So this is the first step of the manipulation. Now in the second step, Z0 is known here, Z1L is unknown, and we will now substitute Z1L using this expression where we have I2. So I2 comes into picture after this stage with the help of this equation. So this VDM, we can take Z1L on this side, Z1L is equal to Z0 square I1. So this becomes VDM into RL 1 plus I2 by I1L is equal to Z0 square I1. We can maybe label these equations. So this is from 4. So now we have I1, I2, VDM, but we now have I1L, the current provided by first amplifier after the transmission line. So we have to now get rid of this. So for that we will have to derive expression for this. So we will start from those equation FB and FC. So if we use FC, we have VDM I1 is equal to minus VL I1L. So this is the equation for FC for this scenario. So here we have to find out I1L and get rid of this VDM, I1L from here. So we are going to use FB, which for this equivalent case will take form VDM by I1 into VL by I1L is equal to Z0 square. So now we multiply these two equations. So when we multiply, what we get is on this side VDM square, these two, I1 will get cancelled out, VL will get cancelled out from this side. So what we will get here is, and IL can be taken on this side, so it becomes Z0 square I1L square. So from here we can take I1L square, and we can take square root of this on both sides, so VDM is equal to plus minus Z0 I1L. So from here we can eliminate this I1L, and this turns out to be in terms of VDM, which we know, and Z0, which also is known. So now we can write VDM into RL 1. Sorry, this is G is also here. So this becomes plus I2 by VDM into plus minus J Z0. So now you see that we have arrived at the desired kind of equation containing only I1, I2 and VDM. So we are going to simplify it, multiply this by this thing to this expression. So this is VDM RL plus minus J Z naught RL I2 equal to I1 Z naught square. So VDM RL is equal to, so we want this I2, so we will keep I2 on this side. So plus minus J Z0 RL I2 is equal to I1 Z naught square minus VDM RL, or plus minus J I2 is equal to one by Z0 RL 2I1 Z0 square minus VDM RL. So this can be simplified further. So this will give Z0 by RL I1 minus VDM by Z0. So now we can make the substitution. What we want is VDM to be always equal to VDD, and this is equal to R optimum. This is beta T into R optimum, and this one is beta into IP by 2. So now from 1, 2, 3, this becomes plus minus J I2 is equal to Z0 is R optimum, RL is beta T R optimum, I1 is beta into IP by 2, VDM becomes VDD, and this is R optimum. So this turns out to be beta by beta T IP by 2 minus, and keep in mind that this R optimum is equal to 2 VDD by IP. So when we eliminate this, what we will get is IP by 2. So this becomes beta by beta T minus 1 into IP by 2. Or I2 is equal to minus plus J beta minus beta T by beta T into IP by 2. So here we can write this in the exponential form. So if we take fundamental current of the auxiliary amplifier of this form, then the drain voltage of main power amplifier will always be equal to VDD for beta greater than VT but less than the maximum value. So this is what we have been looking for. Now here you can see that what we here have is these two factors are real, and then we have here phage. So here we need phage in the fundamental of I2 equal to plus minus pi by 2, either plus or minus. And we know that when a current passes through a lambda by 4 line from here, from this side to the output side, 1 to 2 side. So it will acquire a phage equal to J beta L. So phage acquired is going to be beta L. So beta L for lambda by 4 line is going to be 2 pi by lambda into lambda by 4 is equal to pi by 2. So that means if we make this much of current flow through this lambda by 4 line, this pi by 2 phage condition will get fulfilled. And that is why before the auxiliary power amplifier, we have put a line lambda by 4 length. So when the current reaches to the input of this main power amplifier, it would have acquired a phase of pi by 2. Now from the current of this auxiliary power amplifier, when you extract fundamental, it is going to be of this form. So this is the reason why we have a lambda by 4 line before the auxiliary power amplifier. But the lambda by 4 line after the main power amplifier is there to isolate the drain voltage of the main power amplifier and the load. So for the higher efficiency of main power amplifier, we wanted the drain voltage to be VDD. However, we want the load to continue to get a current of type proportional to the input. So that is why lambda by 4 line has been inserted there. So this part is okay. Now the second objective is going to be to show that here this voltage becomes VDD for higher input if the I2 is of this form. However, what we want is that load should continue to get a voltage VL which should depend only on beta, because load is supposed to get amplified version of this input. So the voltage requirement condition at the both the ends of this lambda by 4 line are very different. So now we are going to show that although this voltage is fixed to VDD, this is going to vary with the input. So what we have to show is proportional to VI. That means it depends upon beta for the higher input. So in this case, again we have to start from those same equations FB and FC. Here these two equations. Now what is our objective is to find out this VL. So we need to find out VL and then see that it depends upon beta. So this time we are going to invert it and then multiply. So VDM I1, now we are going to change left side to right and right to left and then multiply with the previous equation. So Z0 square is equal to minus VL I1L into VDM VL divided by I1 I1L. So you can see that I1L will get cancelled out and VDM will get cancelled out. So and this I1 becomes I1 square Z0 square is equal to minus VL square. So this implies VL square is equal to minus I1 square Z0 square, that is VL is equal to plus minus G Z0 I1, which is plus minus G or optimum. I1 is beta IP by 2. So this R optimum IP by 2 is equal to VDD. So VL becomes plus minus G beta VDD. So you can see that we continue to get the load voltage fortunately, which is dependent upon the input. So as the input changes, load voltage changes. Now of course it has a phase difference of equal to pi by 2, but that is not very important. What we were looking is the linearity relation between the load voltage and the input. So that is preserved here. So now the circuit performs well. That means output is proportional to input. Main power amplifier continues to get VDD voltage. That means power dissipation is going to be very low. So now we have to find out what will be the efficiency of this complete amplifier. So for that, we will try to find out two things before we proceed for the efficiency calculation. First is that now the load perceived by the current coming from main power amplifier is Z1L. So we'll try to find out the expression for this Z1L so that we can use it easily during the power calculation to the load. So Z1L, because of load modulation or load pooling, is I2 1 RL into 1 plus I2 by I1L. So here we have to find out the expression for I1L and ultimately express Z1L in terms of R optimum. So here we have already found out from the previous analysis I2 is equal to beta minus beta t by beta t into IP by 2 e raised power minus plus j pi by 2. So this I2 is known. We now need to write this I1L in terms of known quantities. And recall that we have already derived this equation Vdm is equal to plus minus Z0 I1L. Right. So this becomes Vdd, because for the higher input this dm is fixed to Vdd and Z0 is anyway our optimum. And this is I1L. So, and this can be written as R optimum I1L e raised power plus minus j pi by 2 for this quantity. So our objective is to find out I2 by I1L. So now we can multiply these two equations. What is the numbering? So equal this as 5, this as 6, this as 7. So we can multiply these two, 6 into 7 gives us I2VDD is equal to beta minus beta t by beta t Ip by 2 e raised to minus plus j pi by 2 or optimum I1L e raised to plus minus j pi by 2. So here these two exponentials, they get cancelled out, become 0. And here we have I1L. So this can be taken on this side to find out the desired ratio. So I2 by I1L into VDD is equal to beta minus beta t by beta t, then Ip by 2 or optimum. And recall that this quantity is actually equal to VDD. So this I2 by I1L becomes beta by beta t minus 1. So 1 plus I2 by I1L is actually beta by beta t. So now we can go back to our original equation, this one. So therefore Z1L is RL into beta by beta t. Let us call this as 5A. And recall that load value is equal to beta t into R optimum. So Z1L is beta into R optimum. So we will be using this equation later on. So this is one fact that we need, and second thing that we will require is when we start calculating the efficiency, we will be required to know the DC current drawn by the auxiliary power amplifier. So that will allow us to find out the DC power drawn by the auxiliary power amplifier. So for that, we will have to find out the DC current from the auxiliary power amplifier. See, the fundamental current from auxiliary power amplifier is I2, and I2 is beta minus beta t by beta t into Ip by 2 e raised to minus j pi by 2. So the fundamental current is the fundamental of half wave rectified current produced by the auxiliary power amplifier. So the drain of auxiliary power amplifier will have this type of current. And fundamental of this is this one. Right. So we know that fundamental of this type of waveform is half of this amplitude. So phase part we will overlook for the moment because this will be taken care by the lambda by 4 line. So this will be now presenting all the components of this current. So here we see that this half factor is there. That means this factor multiplied by IP must be the amplitude of this. That means the amplitude of this one, this is beta minus beta t by beta t into IP. So if the auxiliary power amplifier drain current is of this form, which will be there for class B, so that is why we are taking both the power amplifiers into class B mode of operation. So for auxiliary power amplifier acting in class B, drain current is going to be of this form. If the amplitude is of this form, if this value, then the fundamental is going to be half of this factor 2, and this of course is from lambda by 4. So now if this is the amplitude of the drain current of the auxiliary power amplifier, we know that the DC current in this waveform is the amplitude divided by pi. So the DC current from auxiliary power amplifier is going to be the amplitude of the drain current divided by pi. So it is going to be this thing. So now we have accumulated all the necessary expressions, so we can now proceed to find out the efficiency. Since the entire working of this DPA is divided into two regions, the lower and the upper, so we will have to find out efficiency for lower region and the upper region. So for DPA, the efficiency will be having two separate expressions for lower region. That means when input is greater than 0 but less than equal to beta t, and efficiency for higher region when the input is greater than the threshold and less than equal to the maximum. So for these two regions we will have to find out efficiency. So let us first find out eta dl. So this is going to be the power to the load, RF power to the load, divided by DC power drawn by the Doherty power amplifier. But for this lower region, we know that the equivalent circuit will contain only the main power amplifier. The auxiliary power amplifier is going to be off. So here DC power drawn will be the DC power only due to the main power amplifier, and the power delivered will be the power delivered by this main power amplifier to the load. So here if we see in terms of complete circuit, this is in class B operation. So we have this scenario. So main PA is, this is the main PA being fed by VDD, and here it will draw certain DC current also, IDC, which will be the DC of this drain current waveform, which is going to be half rectified, right? So here first let us find out PDC. So PDC drawn, DC power drawn by the main power amplifier is going to be DC voltage, which is VDD multiplied by IDC. Since the fundamental of this current I1 is IP by 2 into beta, so the DC is going to be beta IP by pi. The same idea that we used to find out the DC for the auxiliary power amplifier. So peak is going to be IP, beta IP. So DC is going to be this. So this is the DC power drawn by the main power amplifier for the lower input. Which will be proportional to the input. So now we will have to find out what is the load power delivered by this amplifier for this case. So here VL is the load voltage and the current is I1L. So RF power to the load is going to be VL square divided by 2RL. So here we will have to find out the expression for VL in terms of I1, because I1 is known to us. So we want to relate this VL in form of this one. So if you carry out the exercise using FB and FC equation, what will turn out is VL is equal to plus minus J Z0 I1. So PL for the lower region is Z0 square I1 square by 2 RL. And I1 we know in form of beta. So we can write Z0 square by 2 RL into beta IP by 2 whole square. So here we know power to the load, RF power to the load, and DC power drawn by the main power amplifier. So we can find out efficiency for this lower region, that is eta DL is equal to PL by PDC. So this becomes Z0 square beta square IP square by 8 RL into beta VDD IP, and in the numerator pi. So here we can make the substitution for Z0 RL in terms of R optimum. So Z0 is R optimum, RL is beta T into R optimum. So if you make this substitution, this efficiency will turn out to be this pi by 4 R optimum IP by 2 VDD beta by beta T. Now we know that this factor is equal to 1. So finally, for the lower domain, the efficiency is pi by 4 beta by beta T. So if we plot this function. Then we see that it has a linear relation for this lower region, and actually we are solving this, or we have derived this for the lower region only. So this is going to vary like this. So in the pure class B, the efficiency would have varied like this. It would have started from here and gone to pi by 4 for the maximum input. And that is the definition of maximum input. But for the Doherty power amplifier, main power amplifier achieves this maximum efficiency for even a smaller input. And this is what we can choose. And in fact, it is decided by the designer or the user. For example, this can be taken as 1 by 2. Beta t is equal to 1 by 2 or 2 by 3 or 3 by 4, wherever he wants. So even for lower domain, it offers more efficiency compared with a conventional class B. So now our objective will be to find out efficiency for the higher region of the input for this region. So for the higher region, we know that the auxiliary power amplifier also comes into existence. So it will also consume certain amount of DC power. So eta D for higher input, that is for beta greater than threshold and up to equal to the maximum value. So in this scenario, both the amplifiers come into existence and both will draw the DC power. So total DC power consumed is going to be DC power by the main power amplifier plus DC power by the auxiliary power amplifier. And both the power amplifiers, they are in class B. So DC power by the main power amplifier is VDD into IDC, so which is VDD into beta into IP by pi. So expression is similar to what we obtained for the lower region. And the DC power by the auxiliary power amplifier is also going to be VDD, because auxiliary power amplifier is also class B. Its drain is connected to VDD through the inductor. So this is going to be same as VDD. And the DC current by the auxiliary power amplifier, which we derived sometime back, and its expression is VDD into, it will have same form as the fundamental, D by pi. So this is the DC power drawn by the second power amplifier. Yeah, so this becomes, so now we can add these things. So this is so. So PDC total is sum of these two, which is beta plus beta minus beta t by beta t into VDD IP by pi. So this is the DC power. Now comes the RF power consumed by the load, or RF power delivered to the load. So in this case, both the power amplifiers are responsible for the RF power. So for finding out RF power, what we will have to do is use this voltage across this load to find out the RF power, or maybe this current. We cannot use only this one or only this one. So we will express the RF power to load PL as VL square divided by 2RL. And here keep in mind, we will have to use the physical load, not the load perceived by first amplifier or the second amplifier. So what is known to us is actually I1, so we will try to get rid of this load in terms of I1 current, and I1 will be ultimately replaced in terms of the drain voltage, which is VDD. So we know that from the Ohm's law, for this case I1, VDM and Zin can be related. So you can have I1 Zin is equal to VDM, where Zin is the Z1L transformed by lambda by 4. So I1 Z0 square by Z1L is equal to VDM. So I1 becomes this expression, and this VDM is VDD, this Z1L we have already derived, this turns out to be beta or optimum, and Z0 is R optimum square. So I1 is beta VDD by R optimum. So therefore, total RF power to load during the higher input case is Z0 square I1 square by 2RL is equal to Z0 square 2RL. I1 is beta square VDD square divided by R optimum square. And here you can see that Z0 is R optimum, so this cancels out, and what is left here is 1 by 2 beta square, and this is beta t into R optimum, so this is beta t VDD square by R optimum. So this is the RF power delivered to the load. So now to find out the efficiency, we will have to divide this one by the DC power, which we have derived here. So this is 12, this is 13, so eta d for higher is PL by PDC total, that is 13 divided by 12. So if you make this substitution and carry out the simplification, where keep in mind that we are going to get IP, and that IP also has to be eliminated using this R optimum is equal to 2VDD by IP. So what we will get here ultimately is pi by 4 beta square by beta into 1 plus beta t minus beta t. So this is going to be efficiency for the higher input. So we can now write the overall efficiency for DPA. For lower one, which we had already derived, for higher is pi by 4 beta square beta t minus beta t. This is when beta is greater than beta t but less than equal to 1, and for that case we had pi by 4 beta square by beta t but this is not square here. So now we can take beta t is equal to 1 by 2, so that means input is half, so therefore in terms of power, input power, this will be 20 log 1 by 2, so this will turn out to be minus 6 dB. So when you choose threshold equal to half of the maximum input in terms of power, that is called 6 dB, so input power is going to be 6 dB less than the maximum input. So that is why this threshold is also something called as 6 dB backed off power. Backed off power means reduced power. So for 6 dB backed off case, eta d is going to be, you can see, pi by 2 beta, and for this case, this will turn out to be pi by 2 beta square by 3 beta minus 1. And here, if you plot the efficiency curve, this is pi by 4, so this will turn out to be like this for the lower region, for the upper region it will be like this. And as I pointed out, for the class B, this is going to be the efficiency. So here we see that overall efficiency for Doherty power amplifier is going to be more.